When I became supervisor, I said when you felt comfortable and a time to maybe want to engage a little bit more with the board, come on in. We can have multiple conversations over the course of whatever makes the most sense. And of course, I asked Mel and Aaron to be here as well as they supervise the park in particular. So just want to kind of bat it out. This was an aerial view of the general location that was shared before of the approximate location of some of the land area that we may want to see you folks acquire, correct? So can you share with us kind of what you've done? You have a committee now?
Yeah.
All right, is it all you folks? Is it other members?
Our chairman's right there.
Lucky you, right?
He's here on the committee and there's other ones.
Yeah, we have the committee basically is made up of a couple of folks from the fire district, at-large members from the fire department, the chief, first assistant, and then two community members.
Okay.
One from the town of Skylar and one from the town of Plattsburgh.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because the district does cover both towns.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So in kind of assembling your committee, are you looking, I mean, this is for the board's education as well, are you looking at other sites or are you really kind of honing in on really trying to maybe make something work at the Katieville Park?
We've considered other sites. I wouldn't really say that we're looking at other sites. We've considered, and I guess in a nutshell, it boils down to that park location seems to fit best.
What was left for me as some resources, and it was fairly limited, some of the layouts and sketches and stuff, was it was approximately 7.5 acres. Is that still about what you're looking for?
Yeah, that should be sufficient.
Yeah,
okay.
One of the things that the district is working on too, and I think, Tommy, you could answer best there, when you're going to go up to bid for the architect. No, that's in discussions.
That's a table on the table tonight.
On the table for your meeting tonight. So, probably sometime after the first of the year, the thought process is get the basic building design before we move forward with land. Let's make sure the building that we need to have is going to fit that piece of property. Are we going to be able to fit that in? Is it going to work? So we don't want to go and purchase. There's to find out after the fact that, oops.
There's a thing in the back of our minds that we might want to consider having enough land to hold our field day if we should ever lose our presence site. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's why we're looking for more than just enough room to put a station, and we're looking for a little bit more for that. And also, who knows, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, might need an expansion on the station. It'll be where we are now with the current station where we can expand.
And you were current. You've been at your current site for 50 years, or over 50 years.
63 years.
Okay. Yeah.
64 years.
Yeah.
That's the original.
Yeah.
Site original.
The front two days are the original. Okay.
And you've gone through a lot of modifications of that building to make it work over the years. Too, right? We dropping the
lowered
floor.
Lowered floors, raised doors.
Put on the second floor. Put on the back. Put on the side. There's been a lot of renovations to that building. Yeah.
Now, one of the questions I got was talking to South Plattsburgh, and they got some land from the town for their station. They ended up with a 50-year lease for a dollar or something like that, and then a guaranteed for the next 50. I guess they could get a 99. Is that an option?
I'll be honest, I think anything is a possibility right now in this stage. As we look at what the options are, we'll collect all the information, we'll see what makes the most sense for the town, for you folks. I can certainly look into that.
And another thing is, could we have the land donated?
Jim, can you speak to that at all?
Yes, I can, actually. I've got an opinion here. This is under sale of land. It says, I just happen to have it in this book here from, I think, maybe about a year ago. It says here, a town may convey real property which it no longer needs to a fire district without consideration. That was an opinion of the controller back in '73. After, I mean, this printout that I came, this is from 2015, but at that time, it could be done, and I'll just read it once again. Town may convey real property which it no longer needs, we have to a fire district without consideration, without money.
So it is possible.
It's possible.
The way that reads.
Yeah.
It's legally possible.
And what was in, is there any chance, I mean, I'm really pushing it here, but we could get some...
We could build a fire station.
Well, get the grounds ready.
Why not?
It's good enough.
The questions that I asked you.
Help on that?
I think that, again, there's a lot on the table.
Right.
Ultimately, what I would hope for you folks is to put your wish list, you know, truly a wish list of how much land are you actually looking for? You know, what are some of the things that you're looking for from us? And also, potentially, what are you able to provide? And that might help develop this relationship a little bit further. When I think of the field day, for example, and the park, I think it's such a natural, you know, location to, you know, cross-pollinate between what the town does and what you folks do.
Right.
I think there's a wonderful opportunity that you become stewards of the parklands just because you're close proximity. You know, many of the fire departments have community rooms. I don't know what your final, you know, building will look like, but I would imagine that, you know, there might be something like that where it's close proximity to, you know, the park may be great for community groups and stuff like that.
And that is one of the things that we're having to bring out. There will be a community room. There will be a meeting room / community room.
Yeah.
Obviously, that will be available to the
community. And we have outside access, but they won't be in the rest of the building.
Right.
You know, yeah, at least separate access, so they're not in,
And the same way with the bathrooms. We'll be able to access from this side or this side, and just be able to be locked so that they can't go into the base.
Okay.
Yeah, we've put that in, because we get a lot of requests for them to use our station now, but with the stairs, kind of hard.
Yeah, very difficult.
And there'll be cooking facilities and all that stuff there, so where your little building over there now, it would be open for sure.
Well, I think it's going to afford us the opportunity also to have more community events, be it a pancake breakfast once a month, similar to what Morrisonville does. We really can't do that now in the current setting.
With carryover downstairs.
Mel, do you have any thoughts or comments or questions? And I mean, obviously, tonight isn't the last of the conversation, but I think this is a good first step.
No, I think it would be a good idea, as you were kind of getting there, is maybe if you give us a proposal of the things that you just talked about, kind of writing down your interest, gives us a better idea. You know, I mean, when you talk about having enough land for a field day, maybe you can just use the land that's there.
Well, that's,
you know what I mean? You know, stuff like that. But if we see it, we can probably come up with some ideas too that might help out also.
Do you have a rough... what we're talking about on the map?
Yes.
So we've got a couple of different...
This is the original.
This is what was shared with me. I mean, and again, this is very rough.
I was talking to Melvin. If we could get down this way more on the road, so we could come out without being closer to the intersection.
Yep.
Because this would be our access in and out for the truck. Not Route 3.
Right.
Oh, okay.
We'll come out onto Gowdle. So the more we get here from the edge of the Wolfgang's own property, this way, you know, maybe come this way and less here.
Yeah.
Maybe come this way and hold it, you know. It's, that was one of the first things I talked to Bernie about, was getting more here.
Mm-hmm.
It would involve these couple holes here.
So we'll be able to look at that a little bit closer when you have an idea of your design and how you need to set it and that kind of thing, and then we can kind of then maybe get a better idea of where we want to go there.
Get an architect and
Hi guys.
Hi, Mel.
And then my only other concern, which if there wasn't help with removing some of the land or whatever, that's quite a big hill right there. People don't realize it because of the trees, but I used to slide down that hill when I was a kid. That's a lot of fill to be taken away from right there. More toward behind the houses than it is on this section right here, but once you get over more.
You get into here, you got some fill.
Like where the little jog is, that's a pretty good sized hill right there.
But you got a lot more fill in here than what it would take to fill in the hole that's there. That's what I was asking about. The town maybe hauling it up into where the old dump is.
And that's why I said there could be a lot of possibility. I can't commit right here and now, but I think that by having this conversation and understanding what is kind of the long-term wishes, you know, what I admire about all of our fire departments and districts is, you know, you do such an incredible service to us, not only, you know, by literally going into the fire, as they say, you do a great service by, you know, helping us manage taxes and a number of other things by being volunteers. And we really appreciate that. And, you know, Meg and I talk regularly about all the different departments, and we use you folks just as one example because of the field day. But you also have a wonderful sense of community and traditions with, you know, the Christmas tree lighting and a number of other things. And so do the other, you know, fire departments and districts. But if there's a way to identify some possibilities of doing some of the wish list things, and yeah, I think that would be our hope. But we got to figure out what are the needs and what are the wants.
One other thing I mentioned, I said you can be conveyed without consideration, without money. I don't know, and I can check this out, I don't know if work could be done by the highway department without payment.
And there may be something, you know, doing stuff at cost, or, you know, who knows? I mean, I think that's really where we need to get into some of the conversations. Well, if we have some of the equipment, maybe we can.
Getting the trees cut out of there.
That's nothing.
That's nothing, but just stumping you after.
Right.
You know, digging the stumps out and get rid of them. Mm-hmm. Now, another thing while we're talking, is the gas line going through there soon?
I can add that to the.
I think it's 2017.
Well, yeah,
spring start. Mm-hmm. Spring start was on the list.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's supposed to be
2017.
Well, it was supposed to go through originally when they did it. They had everybody on the street with one sign, and they said, oh, not enough. That's what they told us.
Yeah, and there's been a little bit of moving target on the NYSEG. Yeah.
You know, I jokingly say, you know, my picture's on a dartboard in the basement down there, okay? Because, you know, they did not want to bother with residential.
Yeah.
They were only after large commercial.
To get to Danbora.
Okay. We won that fight. We won that fight. They were forced to provide, they've been forced to provide service to the residents in the town of Plattsburgh. And not only that, but they were up against serious fines for the violations that they committed. And the Public Service Commission, instead of just having the state of New York collect the fines, okay, those fines really have been used to defray the cost of providing this service to the residential users. And so, I mean, this is, and we have to say, we're very pleased with the fact that they are following that plan that's been put together. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean that we are sitting back, fat, dumb, and happy. Okay, we're watching and make sure that thing is.
Well, that's going to have a, I mean, if it's 2017, it's no problem because we're never going to have anything in the ground by then anyway.
Yep.
But I just wanted to make sure it's going to be there.
Yep.
Because it's going to be one of the big things for.
Timetable? I mean, when you start. What'd you say?
That's why we got to get an architect and feasibility studies.
You're all very initial right now.
Yeah. It's amazing how.
We have to find out what the architect says so we can find out how much money we're talking. We're not even certain we can afford amortization on the bonds.
Sure.
So, we gotta find that out. I mean, we're working, we gotta get $70,000 a year budget.
Some professionals.
We gotta pay $100,000 a year for a bond. Can we afford that? And, you know, we gotta ask those questions, and we gotta figure that out. So that's why we're looking.
Because the longer we wait, the more the state sets in, we gotta have this, you gotta have this.
And the longer we wait, more likely the interest rate is to go up, but we're, you know, we're trying to do this in an orderly fashion, but we can't have a timetable just yet. And we're ready for that.
So once we get an architect and he can, we present him with what we want, and he'll, I guess, a feasibility study that this piece of property is even acceptable, right? That'd be the next step, and then give you the wish list.
Yeah, I would say, I would actually.
We can do the wish list anytime.
Yeah, I would do, you may wanna do two wish lists in a sense. One is the, you know, the kind of the preliminary in the sense of this is what we hope to have, and that might actually be helpful to the architect to know what's going on, you know, it might be helpful in that. And then you might come up with a secondary kind of list of sorts of, you know, now that we've looked at three different building designs, for example, this is the one we're going with. You know, hey Mel, could you move that disc golf hole? And she might say.
Right into a neighbor's front yard.
Yeah.
Really nice spot.
You know, and she might say, would you be willing to put in a disc, you know, a new disc golf, you know, like some type of train type thing? So there's lots of different ways that I think we can go about this.
Okay, we'll do that. If you, we'll find out on donating the land, you know, and in-kind services and stuff like that. You know, so when we give you can, you know, something.
Jeff, can I send that out, please?
I think the other part to it is, certainly you can do this at the firehouse, but I just leave this to you as a reminder, if you ever wanna have a community meeting for residents to understand what you're doing. We have two projectors in here, you can use this conference room. Especially if you want to do it in the winter months, the bay can be kind of cold and, and stuff like that.
But
so
we want to have people come through the station with all the equipment.
That's part of what we want.
Everything we have.
Yeah.
We have the Christmas party, we take everything out. They don't realize how tight it is. Okay, so if you can find out that stuff for us, we'll get this list back to you.
Not to say we won't use your services, but the initial public meetings have to be at the station.
No, absolutely. I'm just saying, as you move forward, there's different things. You're not a bother to, you know, let us know what you need, and we'll be as helpful as possible.
And Mel, we could even do a skating rink off the side of our property, because we're not gonna have a standpipe in the station. We just run right over, we can fill your ice rink for you.
Bring it over, right over here somewhere.
That is beautiful. Love it. See, partnerships, that's what it's all about.
Down here, easy enough, that's good.
Yep.
Everyone wants to play disc golf, they do it on ski.
There you go. Something new.
And I would just remind you, Meg is your official liaison for the group, but feel free to reach out to any one of us, and you know, as you continue to proceed through this process, let us know, and we can invite you back to have some of this conversation. But just having the initial dialogue, I think, becomes very helpful.
So that's basically what tonight was, you know, thinking about. Let you know what we're doing, and whatever we can jointly accomplish, we accomplish.
Sure. Very good. And
I'll give you a dollar now if you want to lease
that. That'll take care of the in-kind payment as well.
So, and you folks are doing the annual field day next year, right? Correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Correct.
Yeah, we have something else we're moving to.
They have the meetings planned now, good. So we can start up in January.
Definitely.
That's one of the tree lighting is the 10th.
That's one of the things our commissioners need to make, is approving that field day.
Excellent.
And just protocol, I guess you call it.
Sure. Well, I know you folks had another meeting to get to, and tried to slide this in during a little bit of a window, so we appreciate it. And
thank you.
Appreciate you guys being
here. Thanks, folks.
Appreciate it.
Any comments, questions from you? All right.
I don't need that until tomorrow.
You want to take this, too?
Today's Monday. I'll give you the till Friday.
Thanks again.
Be well.
All right.
Back of that. Well, Chuck, I missed the window for the decorating contract.
It was approximately 7:48 when I began this. I'm going to do a quick roll call here. Tom is absent tonight. Barney's here, Hank's here, Ricky's here, Jim's here. Again, anything for public comment?
It's 7:48?
You're in 6:48.
The 6:48, sorry about that.
Boy, that was long.
Thank you. Deborah, anything for public comment? All right. Ricky, I put this on here. I don't know if you have much of anything you want to say about this, but you and I had the New York State, an individual from New York State Archival or Archivist come to talk about the vault downstairs.
I answered her the other day and I said that both of us probably will be there to meet.
Okay. Do you see, have you had a chance to do any more research on the records management kind of?
Well, I've got the programs all set up. I mean, as far as the program is, and it's up and running, it works good. I mean, there's, you know, I'm saying it's just uploading all of the stuff that's down there and getting the old stuff taken out and the new stuff put in this year. That's what we're starting to do. I mean, it's little by little, it's getting upgraded.
Do you see any value in trying to go on after any of the other grants that you spoke of, anywhere from shelving?
We did that. We applied for it and it got turned down. I've got the request and the amount for the grant and stuff that we applied for, but that got turned down.
Why was it denied, Ricky? Can you remember? Just information purpose for me.
Money. We looked at, I don't know, it was $60,000. They got a price from the same company that put ones in the Clinton County building. They were rolling, so you could roll them together, and it would give you three times the amount of space that we're using. But unfortunately, they got turned down.
Do you think it's worth revisiting that this year?
No, we can. There's nothing, you know. I still got the paperwork. I'm just going to dig it out.
Okay. And just since we're on record management,
is that state grant money?
Yeah. Any updates on Chris going downstairs and?
Well, we've been doing that. An hour here and an hour there when we can do it. So.
And when's her? When do you go into the 8 to 4 hours?
Well, sometimes as soon as she learns all the stuff that's coming, and, you know.
Would you have a tentative timeline for us on that?
It's hard to say because she's not fully. She just got certified by the Department of Health to do all the record stuff now. You know, marriages, death, births, and all of that stuff. So once she gets, you know, acclimated to doing it, and there's no mistakes on it, then, you know, we can move forward onto it.
But do we have other work that she could be doing?
She does, every day.
No, that's not what I meant. Do we have, I guess what I want to say, do we have work that's not being done that she could be doing, okay, because she's...
Other than she's
up to speed. She's up to speed on work, but she doesn't have the allotted time to be doing that work right now.
Now, the only thing that she hasn't done is spent more time in the vault. But other than the other stuff that's in the office, all the records and stuff I pulled out and had her go over stuff, so she understands it until she actually gets to fill it out. But the only thing she hasn't done is spent time downstairs. I brought her down to spend maybe an hour and a half or so. I showed her the program on the computer that was set up, that Angela set up down there. Took the program that I had upstairs and transferred it to downstairs computer. So now these two, she can do work down there and update it to my computer, so it's upstairs too. So, as far as the records go, but that's, you know, she got to go from box by box and pull up like all the accounting stuff that's in there. Okay, so there's 2 pages of accounting stuff. So she got to run that, go to each box and confirm that what's in the box is what's on the computer physically.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the same time, get rid of the old stuff that's there so they can put the new stuff down. That's what takes the time. So if somebody goes down and pulls something out of a box, and according to the sheet, it's supposed to have 15 different things in that box. Well, 9 of the things are there, but the rest are missing. So, you know, that's what's taking, consumes all of the time. You remember that, so. But I mean, it's a logistical nightmare. Because there's so many fingers involved, they go down there, water and sewer goes down every day just about to pull something out of a box. But does it go back in? I have no idea. You know, so it's just the same thing with codes and zoning. We changed locks on the thing 3 years ago. Art changed the locks. So I was the only one that had a key. Mysteriously, codes and zoning has a key. Water and sewer has got a key. Planning department's got a key.
Ricky, I think...
Plus I got a key.
I think right now, Ricky, if you were to think about it, though, if we were reliant on only having the clerk's office
right,
key...
Right, you couldn't do it.
It wouldn't work because...
It wouldn't work. I understand that.
So,
I mean, that's why everybody goes down. And I try to emphasize to them, if you take some out, put those red cards in, mark the thing on the red cards that you take out.
I think the other big concern that we've talked about a couple of times now as a board, and this really wasn't the primary part of the conversation, because I'm glad to know that you're going to go to that training and workshop, but is that the clerk's office, we need to find something really by the beginning of the new year at the absolute latest to get that coverage between, you know...
It works. You tell me, I've asked Elaine and I've asked Jackie, how many times people come to the counter when I'm not there?
Mm-hmm.
One or two. And most of the time it's over something stupid. You know, there's nobody that's complained that I'm aware of,
mm-hmm.
that any of the departments, whether it be codes and zoning or planning, that's came here to pay anything that we couldn't do. The only thing they can't do is take your credit card. Not like today, I had to turn 2 people down from codes and zoning because we don't take Discover card or we don't take American Express.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to either come back with a check or cash.
I think part of Ricky is if, you know, she can only do a limited amount of things, but she can do some things, it gives a face to that office, though. So whether it's 1 person in a day or 10 people in a day, whether it's a handicap sticker or a dog license or paying for, you know, a permit, it's the accessibility of the office that the board seemed to have...
Right, but there are so many different programs now between the stuff for codes and zoning and for recreation over there. We only used to have like 10 or 12 in there. Now there's 40-some
mm-hmm.
different codes into it.
Mm-hmm.
If it's coded wrong for the thing, at the end of the month, I got to go back and change every report.
Mm-hmm.
And I've done that twice now.
So does she not have the skills then, is what you're saying?
Well, it's just, it's how to interpret what they're asking her to do onto it. That's what the problem is. It lies with a lot of the way that the program, especially planning department, has got so many different things for getting a permit.
Mm-hmm.
That it's listed, I think there's 12 or 13 different permit listings.
Mm-hmm.
Onto it. They're not all alphabetical. They're all mixed in the whole system on the thing. So you've got to scroll down to get the right one. If you ask her and it's not the right one, I can't remember what it is, but there's 3 different things that are the same, but the ending of them is different. That's, you know, it's on a permit process.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to be, if you do it and it doesn't get caught right away, then when you do the monthly report and Michelle comes down and says, well, this is wrong, Marie comes down and says, well, this was supposed to be a building permit, but it's a building rental, which is not her department, so it shorts, that one mistake shorts Melody, it shorts her, and it shorts, you know, I mean, it goes all the way around, so you gotta go back through and find the date that it was issued and change it from that date or that permit number back to what it should be.
So Ricky, I guess part of my question is, if you were to retire tomorrow, let's play the hypothetical game, which, if you were to retire tomorrow, are you saying that no one could be the town clerk?
Oh, they could be the town clerk, but it would take them at least a year to learn everything.
That's worrisome.
It is.
That's me.
If I was to have another heart attack and die, you guys would be out in the water with a rowboat.
But that's what I'm saying, Ricky, is that we've got to find a methodology.
Well, you can, but it takes time to train people, Michael.
Ricky, I'm not arguing with you. I'm trying to find a way to find a solution, because while people may not, you know, complain to you, there are people here in the morning. I mean, we can.
If you want me to put her on, I'll put her on tomorrow morning at 8:00. And if she doesn't do anything from 8 to 10, then what do you want me to do?
I think she becomes the face for the office, and I'd ask the board, do you feel as though having that office open at 8:00 adds value?
I think you try to. There has to be information that's available that she could be studying, that she could be looking at, would be acquainting herself with the process.
But we have the handbook from the state. But the program doesn't come from the state. It's from a company that the town chose to buy the program from. She's gone over the clerk's handbook and read it from front to back a half a dozen times, but that doesn't tell you anything.
Ricky, I'm not trying to demean your position.
No.
I know you do many more than 20 tasks, but for just simplicity's sake, okay? So that, say there's 20 functions that come out of your office, okay? Would you say fairly that she is trained in 10 of them?
No.
How many would you say out of the?
Right now, handicap and dog is what she's got covered. The rest of the stuff, no.
And what are some of those other tasks that she's?
Well, that's what I'm saying. All of the programs that recreation has, mm-hmm. we had to put back in. Pat had to, accounting had to come in and code all of the new programs that they added. For like skiing, but we have, there's 9 things that go to skiing for whiteface, 13 that go to what's the one?
Gore.
Titus. Okay, Titus. So there's 13 programs there, 9 programs there, mm-hmm. onto it. So you gotta go down through and look, is it a ski, just a ski lesson? Is it a ski rental with a lesson? It is a snowboarding with a lesson.
Sure.
Is it, you know what I mean? There's.
But with that thought process though, Rick, with our programs constantly changing, she's never going to ever see every single example of what we have to offer.
I know that, but we had it set up. This is new stuff that they Park and Rec added this year that I don't even know. So I have to go to when she gives me the paperwork and says what it is on a thing. So I got to go back into the computer, onto it, and pull up the exact thing what it is for that area, because the charges are different. So a ski rental in one lesson at Whiteface is different than a ski rental in lesson at Titus Mountain.
Yeah, but can't you? Isn't it possible to take a look at that and say, okay, I'm gonna give you, you know, X number of examples, okay? I'm gonna give you 10 examples. And you're gonna put these in, just like people came to the window.
There's no training module in it.
No, but do you have...
No, but you can go back and take them out.
Do you realize the logistical amount of work it is to do that?
Can you print the screen?
Well, you got 2 hours of time. You get
Marty, that's ridiculous. I have to back out the accounting thing. Everything has to be approved onto it. I just can't wipe it out of the system without going and having Pat look at stuff, how it's charged.
How long, when did this woman get hired?
3 months ago.
3 months ago. We've had 3 months of work, 3 months that she's been here.
Well, you come tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, and you sit in my office from 8 until 4, and you watch what goes on. It's not just like Jackie Blue taking water bill or a tax bill. It's not even like that. Doesn't even come close.
I don't think we're challenging the complexity of what you do.
It is.
I don't disagree. I guess what we're trying to do is we're trying to create solutions for you, whether it's, you know, to attempt to make it more efficient, whether it's a tip sheet, or what Marty was saying is that sometimes, and I don't want to use the word dummy, but you have a dummy transaction that you can put in there.
There's nothing in the system to do that.
I'm going to call Malone. They fired their clerk. The town hall.
Yeah, but no two. Well,
the town hall fired their clerk.
Yeah, well, okay. Go to the city clerk's office and see how they run it. Their system is close to what ours is. Onto it. They have 4 people working there, full time.
In Malone, they have 4 full time people in their clerk's office.
That's why
they're
broke.
Yep.
would it be helpful if somebody did come to your office and help create manual instructions for all the new tasks?
I've got a book on it, but there's so many changes from the time that we put the book together.
So that's why we could maybe create a new book of our own for this town clerk's office.
You'd have to go, you come and look at the system. You know when you have the drop-down menu, mm-hmm. there was only like 10 things? Now there's 58 or 59 of them in that.
Okay.
And then it's all coded differently.
So.
And then they just added all of the things for skiing. We just used to have one thing you pushed that was either senior skiing, mm-hmm. chaperone skiing, or young person skiing. Now, there's 13 on one and 9 on the other.
Okay, so there's.
And that's only for this time of the year.
Right.
Meg, with your experience,
yep.
would you be willing to dedicate a couple of hours mm-hmm. and try to? And again, Ricky, we're not.
No, I understand that, but you don't really know what goes on in that office until you come and spend time there.
Well, I do know what goes on.
No, you do. Yes.
I work there
for above 2 years. Everybody else.
So, but there's 5 people here who want to help.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. Right. I understand that.
So let's get past all of the problems. And let's find a way to make this work for your office.
Yeah.
It will. It just takes time.
I think we're
offering.
You hired a young lady who I think is a bright young lady.
Oh, she is.
She. I mean, you know, if I thought you'd hired a dumbbell,
I'm not
I'd be the first
that,
one to say, Ricky.
I stand behind her 110% because she's a great person.
She's
just got to have the time to learn it.
Well,
that's all it is.
But we're 3 months into this. We're 3 months into this, and we're saying we can't move a person. We can't move a person into a full time status. You know, that's unacceptable.
Well, it's
we've got to be, you know, further along in the training process.
But.
That's, you know, and so we need to look at how can we improve what we're doing.
She's a student teacher coming into a situation she never worked in there, never did anything else.
Ricky,
so you got to give her time to learn the things that go on.
I don't want to belabor this particular conversation because this is certainly not the means for it. But I'm comforted by the fact that Meg is going to have some conversations with you, see where we can be of assistance. I think ultimately the message, the takeaway, Ricky, is there is a need for the office to be open those additional hours. There's also a need for us to find some ways to assist you to get her some of the additional skills or the ability to do some of the functions in your office so that you're not feeling like you need to triple, you know, check all of the work. We get that.
I have to until I feel comfortable that
sure.
she's learned the process. That's what I'm saying. I could turn her loose tomorrow as far as that goes, but she's only going to be able to do a few things that I think that she's capable of doing at the time where it's correct and you don't have to come back and do it, recorrect it.
Sure.
You know, it isn't, but when you print a monthly report onto it, and I give it to Marie, or I give it to Michelle, and I give it to Melody, and codes and zoning comes down, and Marie said, well, this isn't a building permit, or this isn't a building permit, it should be a building rental. So I gotta go back through and pull up that date and change that from a building rental to a building permit or vice versa on a thing.
All right.
And then it changes the whole structure of fees and everything.
We're gonna move forward.
Okay.
Thank you for that lively conversation, everyone.
You're welcome.
All right, do want to make you aware that we had a conversation last year, or this year, it all melts together, about an RFP request for data collection, and talked with Brian Dowling, our assessor, and asked him to begin to generate the RFP, the scope of work, et cetera, along with a resolution that would allow us to begin to deploy this and start moving this forward. So what I would ask of you folks is, certainly this is draft. I'd like to put this up for consideration next Monday so we can advance this. But I would encourage folks that if you have questions or comments or concerns, Brian did draft this. I think it's a good attempt to kind of get some things collected and move forward. And we'll start to march forward.
Yeah.
I know that Kayla, in particular, has been doing a really great job in the office, and I think has actually taken on and streamlined some different things within the office that she has been really an invaluable asset. So
Tim's on the phone, great.
Yeah. And I think she's also addressed some other things in the office that probably needed to be done differently, but because differently also changes kind of the way the workflow occurs. So questions or concerns, I would encourage you folks to connect with Brian on this particular item.
Yeah, thanks for bringing this forward, Michael, because I talked to Brian Lee on the assessing committee, and we talked about this, and then to add some comment about Kayla, yeah, I've gone in there a couple times to watch the work in progress on the workflow and the reorganization of the files, and even starting to talk about customer service and how to make that better.
So, any other comments on that? I'll just said a while ago that I have a SUNY Plattsburgh Communications course. They've been doing some interesting studies, and more global in nature to start off. You know, web visibility is a direct driver of a region, a community's economy. You know, the more of your local businesses that are online, the mobile accessibility, etc. I mean, think of everything from Yelp to you know, people looking for motels, hotels, you know, and all these different things. So they began to do a study of the Plattsburgh region and found that Plattsburgh, as a region, had a pretty low web visibility for the local economy. So I'm working with this group and in a partnership with the Chamber of Commerce. Next week, we're going to offer a workshop for local businesses to learn how to deploy social media as a fairly inexpensive means to gain web visibility for themselves. There's also the possibility of one of the students continuing through next semester to help us work on some web visibility through social media. So, you know, things like Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, a lot of these things are free in a portfolio that we can use to get information out there. We're already doing it with Constant Contact through a low subscription. But the more that you can put information out to individuals, becomes helpful to educate people and to provide, you know, commentary back to us as well. So I'm really excited about this workshop, and the Chamber has really become a great partner in doing some things with our local businesses. This was kind of a nice follow-up to the Small Business Saturday, because it's great to get people out to shop in the local businesses, but we also want people to know about the wide variety of businesses that we have here in our backyard that some people don't even know that they're necessarily here. We have the Plattsburgh Knife Company, we have Global Sugar Arts, we've got all these different kind of unique businesses. It's a good opportunity to kind of get out in front of them. So more on that to come. So this next item. Pass those down. This is a memo that I got late today from Art. He is seeking to do the town's oil and water separation. Happens every so often. He did put in regards to the service as required for the system, and there's two quotes, ZebraTech being the lowest of the two. So we'll have a formal resolution for consideration next week. He does feel as though this is the time that we want to get this done. It's not something that you want to hold off on. And
what is
this,
an oil water separator?
Yeah.
Can you give that?
Something that separates oil from water.
Oh, thank you. That's how you make a good vinaigrette.
Yeah. Exactly.
So,
it's part of the drain process.
To the best of your ability.
And it's in the drain that, you know, when they're working, the oil.
How was it done in the past?
And all of that.
They've hired it out.
It gets washed in there when they're taking stuff apart.
Yeah, they've hired
it. So it goes into that separate system.
Yeah, they've hired out.
Okay, please tell me what it is and where it is.
Say that again.
What is an oil water separator and where is it located?
It's in the building, out in the shop area.
In the floor.
It's like a channel system. So the idea is to be able to separate the two substances so they're, for lack of better terms in my understanding, a contamination factor. So
like a big septic tank.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So like when vehicles are being worked on, et cetera, et cetera. So,
Michael, is this routine or just every cycle?
Art had expressed that it is routine. It doesn't need to happen all the time, but it gets full. So there needs to be a cycle that occurs.
Okay.
He didn't give me a sense for how often this is occurring,
okay.
But he did say that it is getting full, and rather than getting to the place where it gets over full, you know what I mean, like
mm-hmm.
that kind of lip, he'd rather get it done now. So, and I've
okay. I'm only asking because in case it's got to be a routine as opposed to an emergency.
Exactly.
That's all.
Vehicle,
build it into our budget.
Vehicles will come in. They've been out on the road.
Mm-hmm.
We'll say it's been raining. Okay. They will come in, and there will be fluid that ends up on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. As a result of those vehicles now being inside the building, and that fluid will be a combination of water and oil, okay, and the oil can be grease,
hydraulic fluid, antifreeze, it could be
air.
I think we're wondering, or I am maybe, that if I could, he says ASAP, what was last year, was it ASAP, or?
He may have gotten a heads up that he's got an inspection, that he's been tabbed for inspection.
That's the ASAP.
That's what the ASAP is.
We consider ASAP, but if it can be regularized, then I appreciate that.
That's what I think the ASAP is.
And one of the things, too, that, again, with all of our departments, there's, quote unquote, a committee typically assigned to this. This is something that he felt that there was a need to get through.
Okay.
Typically, he would have driven this to the Building and Grounds Committee, but I wanted to get it before you folks.
Sure.
And, you know, I basically said, is it something that you need to have voted on tonight? And he goes, no. I said, do you need it by next week? He goes, that would definitely be my preference. So, to put it in those terms. Get my steps up tonight. All right.
Inspection. Okay.
Does everybody have the quality of pines proposal? So I think some of you might remember that I've been working with a number of individuals to address some of the concerns that have been developing in Quality Pines over the course of the last several months. We actually held a community forum here. Glenn Michaels, who is one of the assistant attorney generals, was here. Members from Community Renewal, the health department, etc. There's been a number of things that have been developing out there. In addition to that, basically the Clinton County Health Department has been sharing that their infrastructure really needs to be addressed in a number of ways. Okay, one of the ways is that Liz Tedford, through her consulting business, was recommended by the Clinton County Health Department to Mr. Jindal, who is the president of Quality Pines, to look at one method of applying for some funds through the Community Development Block Grant, the CDBG grant, for infrastructure improvements.
What specific infrastructure?
Water pipelines below the ground and some the thing that I did is, before I was even willing to entertain this, I asked Mr. Jindal as well as Liz Tedford to have a conference call with Scott Stoddard and I to talk about the need and what the approach would be, and some of the other communities in the area. I believe Beekman Town was one of them, and possibly Peru was another in the last several years that have negotiated some of the these funds in the process. Ultimately, this is the proposal, the paper. I want you folks to have a chance to review it. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, let me know. We can engage back in the process. You know, I told Mr. Jindal that I was not necessarily for it or opposed. I think that there is some really good merit behind this, especially that community certainly does have a number of issues, and I think the town has an opportunity to be of assistance in working with a program like this. But I want to, you know, facilitate, you know, a conversation, and if people don't have any issues or concerns by next week, maybe we will consider a resolution, but I don't have a draft one right now.
This community, is this general owner? I mean, is this a for-profit business?
Yeah. It is a for-profit.
And it's just and it would seem to me this is just a...
Is out of Vermont?
This is a $600,000 windfall.
Yes. Alexander, Virginia.
Absolutely. And he's been not a good... He has not maintained his properties.
Well, this type of thing incentivizes you.
Well,
of course.
There's a number of things that I'm saying is... he recently purchased this property in the last number of months. Mm-hmm. It's not getting any better. Affordable housing in our community is certainly an issue. And that's why I'm not sold on it one way or the other. Okay, I'm not saying that we should do this. What I would ask the board to do is to give some serious consideration of what are the merits, you know, what are the peaks and the peaks of this. And that's why I asked them to put something in writing, because I'm not trying to shepherd it through one way or the other.
I know that. I'm just thinking, if he bought it recently, bought it at a $600,000 discount because it was in bad shape. You know, like, do you buy an apartment house in bad shape and then say, give me $600,000 to fix it up?
Yeah, you just asked the question I was going to ask Michael, so thanks.
I will say I doubt that he knew the shape it was in.
But even if he didn't, if I buy a car and I don't know the shape that it's in, I don't know that I should get public money to bring it up to
speed. Oh, I understand, Jim. Believe me, I understand that. Okay. And the rationale here that exists is the Clinton County Department of
Health. Right.
Is advancing the proposal because there's a need for low-income housing. And if this part goes down, and we've already had three parks go down in the town of Plattsburgh, all right? We're going to have that much less low-income housing in the town of Plattsburgh.
Well, and not...
It's an issue.
And not even just the town of Plattsburgh, Marty. Our entire region is feeling quite a crunch for affordable housing. Furthermore, there is approximately several hundred people within that, you know, from kids to, you know, mothers, fathers, grandparents, and so on and so forth. So there's, it is not a perfect situation at all. You know, and that's why I'm really torn, you know, on many different levels of this. So, but again, I think that for us to advocate for the residents, you know, and part of the way that the CFA consolidated funding application does is it does afford the opportunity for somebody like him to go after these funds.
I think there's a quid pro quo to be put in place here. If we're going to be the applicant, I think we have every right to say, okay, we want Mr. Jimbo or whatever. The guy in Louisiana, right.
Former governor.
We may want to negotiate something with him on behalf of his tenants.
Yes.
Like, you know, a little minimum rent control situation.
And that,
just so that he can't take this, thank you very much, bang, you know?
And there are a number of other underlying complaints that are currently on the table in this exact area that he, I'm sure, would continue to ignore.
Marty's got a good idea that it should be structured in such a way that we have some control.
This is also, just to let you know, I've shared this with Glenn Michaels.
Yeah.
Okay, because the Attorney General's office is conducting an investigation on a number of things. And again, this is why there is not a resolution before you. But I did want to make sure that we got something in writing to understand what is being asked, proposed, and to give us the full opportunity that if we did want to do something on behalf of the residents. That's the point that I really want to drive home is I have no interest in doing anything for Mr. Jindal. You know, but there's got to be something behind it, and it may be seeking a different property manager. It may be getting them to put, you know, an allowance of a citizen advisory group. I mean, there could be a number of things that are occurring to strengthen and elevate that park from the current standards that it's in. So,
I think it's fair, if not everybody at this table is fully aware of what you've been able to do for the people in that park.
Yeah.
You've done a hell of a job to bring a white light onto that situation, and it needed it.
Thank you. And that's what I say, I'm just trying to be solution focused. You know, to me it's not about helping Mr. Jindal. To me it's not about helping this private business. There are many other factors out there that, God forbid, that this park have to be closed. You know, where would we find, and the stress that it would put on a number of agencies in this area, you know, we could get down a rabbit hole very quickly, but how do we elevate the park? So. Yeah.
Well, he might be able to, and he might not be able to. That kind of money, I would tell you, he's not going to be able to borrow that kind of money to go in and fix up that park.
All right.
Because he's not going to be able to raise the rents to cover that that debt. It just isn't going to happen.
All right. Couple other quick things, and we do have one active resolution that we are going to go back to. We did table the board meetings for 2017. This didn't change. Ricky, do you have a copy of it?
No.
If you could just please read.
What
just the number, I just need to...
It should be 16,234.
Yeah, got it.
Resolved that the town board regular monthly and semi-monthly meetings be held on the first and third Thursday respectively of each month at 6 p.m. prevailing time at the town hall, 151 Baker Road, Plattsburgh, New York. And it be further resolved that on occasions the town board will meet 15 minutes early to distribute material to the councilors and prepare for the meeting. And it be further resolved that as needed, the town board informal work session meetings shall be held on the second and fourth Thursdays of each month at 6 p.m. prevailing time at the town hall, 151 Baker Road, pursuant to section 62 of the town law. And it be further resolved in the event there is a fifth Thursday in any month, meetings will be scheduled at the discretion of the supervisor. And it be further resolved that due to holidays observance, the town board has hereby changed the dates respective scheduling meetings as follows. November 23rd, 2017 be canceled. And it be further resolved that a copy of these changes be posted on the town's website and a copy of the resolution be given to the town clerk and to the finance manager.
All right, is there a motion?
So moved.
Ebert, second. Is your second? Thank you, Faye. Any discussion?
Yes, I asked previously and I have not yet been given an explanation. I asked for a rational reason for why the meeting is being moved from the 7 o'clock prevailing time to a six o'clock prevailing time. We have met at 7 o'clock for as long as I can remember, with the exception of a short time where we did move meetings up at the request of one counselor who then was unable to make the meetings at that hour. And this was during Art LaFave's tenure as supervisor, and the meetings were moved back to the 7 o'clock hour. And we have high school students and college students who come to our meetings. We have adults who come to our meetings, and in my opinion, in many instances, the 7 o'clock time works well for these people. I would obviously lose any argument that tries to say that this is a perfect time for all people. It's crazy. No time is a perfect time for everybody. But it's been an agreeable a time that has worked for years. And I did not get and have not received any indication as to why people or an individual or whatever felt a need to move to an earlier time. And I feel that the request to move the meeting to an earlier time, I'm completely in agreement to move to Thursday. But I felt that the reason to move to an earlier time was an accommodation to one member of this board, and I didn't feel that there was a rationale provided to do that, and I don't think that that's what we should be doing. I don't think that we should be accommodating one member of our board with a change in the meeting time. I think that we should retain the standard time that we have had. I see also a problem with interfering with other meetings that take place here. We have many meetings that start at 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon and run into the early evening. And if our meeting is coming in at 6 o'clock, I think we'll be bumping into each other in those situations, and that's an added problem. Those are all reasons why I will not be voting in favor of this.
Okay. The only comment I had was, when would this commence?
It would start in January. It would be for our new...
Okay,
fine.
We might want to put that in the resolution.
Well, it says town board meetings for 2017 in the title.
Yeah.
Town board meetings for 2017.
And not on my sheet.
No?
How convenient, Jim.
I thought you had me, didn't you?
Jim, as I used to say, leaders are readers, so.
Lawyers are readers. I thought that was the phrase.
Marty, I can't speak, obviously, you know, Tom is not here. We tabled this, and Barb, part of what you said is, because Meg wasn't here, so we'll get to that in a moment, but as the person that constructed the resolution for consideration by the council, I'll tell you the reason by which I put the 6 o'clock in is trying to be a consensus builder by the fact of the conversations that people have had and called, be it ZBA, be it planning board, be it our council meetings, the mausoleum meeting, for example, have all been at different times, and the public has arrived here at that point. As far as college students, I'll give them a nod. They too are adults.
Mm-hmm.
And some adults are not adults. But that people that, I think part of the reason that some of the college kids probably find their way up to the town of Plattsburgh was because it was on a Monday at 7 o'clock. You know, they might have had a night class. Well, there are many other board meetings, you know, in the region. They could go to Peru, they could go to Beekmantown, they could go to wherever it is to meet those things. Our meetings don't tend to last an extraordinary amount of time. I feel like we've been doing good work in the amount of time that we've been allotting, trying to keep people focused. Sometimes it's like cat herding in a tuna fish factory. But, you know, I think that, like anything, if the 6 o'clock time's not working, we can make a corrected adjustment. I just think that, one of the things that I heard from a couple of people was that the later it goes into the evening for those longer nights, when they do occur, it's people that are getting up, going to work the next day, and life circumstances have changed. So I'm not opposed to 6 o'clock, but I'm open to some other things. Barb, Meg?
I'm fine with 6 o'clock.
Yeah, the only question I had, Marty, as you know, was, and I don't want to beat this with beat it to death, was about the attendance, whether it's 6 or 7. You know, taking apart the schedules of people, because times have evolved and shifts are different, and people, and I do think if people want to show up, they will show up for 6 o'clock. I really do. Now, again, this isn't carved in cement, but so I appreciate what you're saying, but I'm fine with 6 o'clock. And I'm not so sure the other person on the board, I can't speak for that person that has any objections to 6 either.
And part of the reason that I am advancing this resolution this evening is there is a shift in our schedule with the Thursday. I want to make sure rooms are reserved. I want to begin to get the public notice out. I mean, and create kind of the new schedule internally within the department heads to start getting materials and stuff. It's a cultural swing. So with that, feeling as though discussion has occurred between the work session a while back, last week and tonight, I'll call for a roll call.
Okay. Mark Mannix?
No.
Meg LePage?
Yes.
Barb Heber?
Yes.
Mike Cash?
Yes. Resolution does carry. All right. Finishing up with the rest of the material here, there are the draft minutes. There is also the periodic estimate number 2 for final water and well exploration testing and waiver of the lien. And then there's the base sewer line slip waiver of lien and project closeout. So next meeting, I anticipate not having many additional changes on the resolutions. I would again ask you folks to reach out to me if you have thoughts and opinions on the quality times item, and RP, I would anticipate seeing us take action on that next week, so we can stay on task. Okay. So, all right. Thank you, folks.
Bye.
And yep. 7:59.
Did you guys start early tonight?
Yes, we started in that 15-minute window to accommodate the fire department.
The fire department had an early meeting.